After you've extracted and transformed your data, the last stage of an ETL pipeline is loading the transformed data to its final destination. In this tutorial, we'll talk about planning the load step of an ETL pipeline and some of the things that you should consider. For our example data, we're going to be loading our transformed data into a JSON file. And we'll also talk about the difference between bulk inserting a large amount of data at once and loading data records one at a time. For our example exoplanet data, we're going to be serializing our data to JSON and then writing it to a file on disk as our destination. We're going to opt to do a bulk insert of all of our data at once into this JSON file. So we're going to be writing all of the data in just one single pass. When it comes to loading data, there's two basic approaches. You can either bulk load all the data at once or insert each data record one at a time. You need to think about the destination you're loading the data into. Does it support bulk loading records where you're making a single insert with multiple records at once? Or are you forced to insert one record at a time? Does the order of the insertions matter? Deciding between the two depends heavily on the destination you're loading the data into. For some systems, it might be more resource intensive to insert records individually, especially if you're talking about hundreds or thousands or millions of records. But it's also possible that an extremely large bulk insert could lock up the database or other system while it processes the unusually large load of data. Bulk loading our data into a flat JSON file is something that we're able to do here because we're working with a relatively small dataset. That's important to keep in mind because in a lot of ETL processes, your final destination isn't actually going to be a flat file or JSON, it might be something like a database. Which brings me to talk about how the destination for your data may be different from what we're doing here. First off, destinations will definitely vary depending on where you want your data to end up. For a typical ETL pipeline, your destination could easily be a database, you could be making the request with the data to an API endpoint, you could be saving it to a CSV file, or pretty much anywhere that you need your data to be. When thinking about how to load your own data into your destination, it's important again to analyze the destination and the access patterns around it. That means thinking about what you need to do in order to get that data into the destination, as well as thinking about any restrictions around using it. So if you're using a database, think about what you need to do in order to connect to that database and insert the records. And also think about what could go wrong with the destination. If you are inserting into a database, is it possible that you're going to overwhelm or bog down the database by inserting a lot of records at once? Think about the size of the data set that your ETL pipeline produces as well. How might that output grow over time? Maybe you're only outputting a couple megabytes of data today, but is it possible that data might grow by an order of magnitude or two in the future? These are important things to think about when you're planning how to load your data to a destination. And finally, plan for failures. There's a really good chance at some point that something might go wrong in all of this. How is that going to affect your system at large if suddenly the output of your ETL pipeline either is unavailable, inaccurate, or it somehow takes down the destination? These are all aspects that are going to be unique to your ETL pipeline and are things that you should think about while planning these steps. So let's implement our bulk loading to a JSON file. First thing that we're going to do is we're going to create a promise-based version of fs.write file. In order to do that, we're going to require the promiseify function from the built-in utilities module from Node.js. Then we'll also require the fs module as well. We'll create the promise-based write file by passing fs.write file into promiseify. Now we'll create a function which is going to help us bulk load the planets to the file. Our bulk load planets to file function takes our array of transformed planets as well as an output file path to write the planet data to. The function will check to make sure that we've actually passed an output file path, and if not, it's going to throw an error letting us know that it's required. Otherwise, we're going to serialize the planet's data to JSON using json.stringify and pass the file path and the stringified data to write file promised. We're returning from this function the promise created by write file promised. If you were bulk loading data to a database instead of a JSON file, this bulk load planets function would instead take an array of records and make a bulk insert query to the database, then return a promise that resolves when the insert operation was complete. Now let's go ahead and use this function in our start ETL pipeline function. We'll create a variable to hold the file path that we're going to be writing this file to. We're using double underscore dir name in order to get the directory name that this file exists in. So we're going to write the file to the same directory, but add a file named out.json. Bulk load planets to file doesn't actually return anything besides a promise, and that promise doesn't resolve with any value. So we're awaiting it without assigning any variable to the return value. Awaiting it allows us to run our console.log on the next line to let us know when the planets have successfully been loaded to the destination. Let's run this file and make sure that everything's working properly. Okay, it ran properly without throwing any errors. Now let's go check our out.json file and see what's in it. There we go, we've got our transformed data loaded to a JSON file. So bulk loading was pretty straightforward. Now let's take a look at how we would insert records one at a time. Here's what inserting records one at a time could look like. First off, on line 55 here, I've mocked an insert record function. The important thing about this mock function is that it takes a single record and returns a promise. So let's take a look at what we're doing. Here on line 72, we're using reduce on the planets transformed array. What reduce does is it iterates over each item in an array, passing in both an accumulator returned from the last iteration and an item from the array. When you use reduce, you pass it a function that runs on each iteration and also an initial accumulator value. But in this example, we pass an already resolved promise as the initial accumulator value to reduce, and we're returning a new promise on each iteration. When the first iteration runs, we're awaiting the already resolved promise so it completes immediately. Then we return a new promise, the promise returned by insert record. That new promise is then passed to the next iteration to be awaited on before invoking the next call to insert record. Using reduce this way allows us to use async and await to sequentially chain any number of promises. It's roughly equivalent to manually chaining each promise with a then handler so that they run sequentially, but this allows us to handle any number of promises without having to hard code in those promise chains. Inserting one at a time can be useful if your destination needs to treat each record as an event coming into the system to make sure that the data is handled appropriately. Whatever your reason for inserting records individually, be aware that this approach results in far many more requests being made to your destination. So be sure to take into account the additional load that this can put on the destination receiving the data. That's part of the reason why we're using this trick with reduce, to make sure that we're not going to overwhelm the resource with a whole bunch of requests happening all at once. But instead, we're only making one request at a time and waiting until it completes before making another. To recap, in this tutorial, we learned how to plan the load step of an ETL pipeline. When planning the load step, you need to think about the destination you're loading your data into, its access patterns, and any restrictions that might apply to it. In our example, we loaded our data to a JSON file as our destination. We also discussed two different ways that you can approach loading your data into your destination: bulk inserting the data, and also loading the data individually record by record. A bulk insert might be the most efficient if your destination supports it, but if you need to load records in individually, you should do it sequentially so as not to overwhelm the destination.